Good afternoon, and welcome to the Commonwealth Club of Silicon Valley. Brought to you from the Cubberly Theater in Palo Alto, my name is Martine Paris. It is my pleasure to introduce today's special guests, Jamie Hyneman and Adam Savage, co-host of the Mythbusters. Jamie Hyneman has worked for several special effects companies overseeing production of models and special effects for blockbuster movies and over 800 television commercials for brands like 7-Up and Nike. Nearly 20 years ago, he created M5 Industries. Besides being the special effects workshop where Mythbusters is filmed, M5 Industries continues to be on the cutting edge of technologies ranging from toy prototyping to green vehicle design. Jamie holds a number of patents and industry awards. He is an avid sailor and longstanding Screen Actors Guild member. Adam Savage has spent most of his life making stuff, toys, futuristic weapons, fine art, and just about anything else you can think of. His career includes actor, animator, graphic designer, theater set designer, carpenter, and welder. He has worked on hundreds of commercials and movies, including The Matrix sequels, Star Wars episodes 1 and 2, and Terminator 3. As a sculptor, Adam's artwork has been represented in over 40 shows from San Francisco to New York. He has also taught advanced model making at the San Francisco Academy of Art. In its 7th season, Mythbusters is widely popular and broadcast in several countries throughout the world. Today's moderator is Kevin Kelly, founding executive editor of Wired and author of the forthcoming book, What Technology Wants. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Jamie Hyneman, Adam Savage, and Kevin Kelly.
Hello. In case you don't know, Jamie Hyneman and Adam Savage. So welcome to the Commonwealth Club. We have some questions for the many people are wondering about. What's one thing about the Mythbusters that's not really apparent from the outside? Can you tell us about something that most people wouldn't know about how the thing works?
Well, most of it is apparent, and that's kind of what's unique about the show, I suppose.
to us, at least.
Yeah, I mean, we occasionally do things like, if there is a different camera angle we need to get or something like that, we'll redo a shot, but pretty much what you see is what actually happened and so on. I guess as far as how we personally deal with it, it's another story, and that's where it kind of gets interesting, I suppose. Adam and I have for example, this disparity between our characters. Adam's more impulsive and energetic, and I'm more calm and methodical, and it's something that you... Yeah. It's something that you are aware of when you watch the show, but you may not be aware of what that does. And specifically, it lends a certain kind of analytical tool to the process that we're about. We see things from two different points of view all the time, and it serves to problem solve for us as well as explain things to the audience.
So do you agree with that? Since there's two versions of everything, do you agree with that?
Yeah, I mean, always picking at each other like scabs usually yields, strangely, the most elegant result. There's actually two things about the way things go behind the scenes that I don't think people realize. Some people think that there's a lot of people working behind the scenes building stuff for me and Jamie, and that's actually not the case. If you see us build it on camera, we've pretty much built it behind the camera as well. We have some help to do welding, and maybe if we have to drill 1,000 holes, we got a couple of guys in the shop who can help us do that. But for the most part, we build everything. But the part that really doesn't make it into the show is that we have an incredible crew, about 25 people strong in San Francisco. And it really starts with our director, Alice Dallow, who's one of the reasons we sound succinct and intelligent. She doesn't even watch us do takes. She just listens to them. And if she doesn't understand, she makes us do it again. She's like, look, I don't understand what you guys are doing. If you can't make me understand, you're screwed with the audience. And then we have these associate producers and researchers who are the people that find things like buses for free that we can wreck or airplanes that we can blow up. And they really do go, I mean, you know, we wanted to do some tornado myths recently, and one of our researchers, I think it was John Hunt, found a shipping company in northern Michigan that has 16 747s. And when you own a 747, I didn't know this, you have to start it up every week. You have to start all of the engines every week just to, as part of the maintenance program. So 16 747s, four engines each. It's a full-time crew of like 40 people just to turn these things on once a week. And John found them. They're fans of the show. They let us do experiments behind the engines while they run them, which would otherwise be a very expensive proposition given the cost of jet fuel. And that level of innovation that that team of researchers brings, the suggestions that come from our sound guy about ways to set up shots, our second cameraman, Scott Sorensen, is an absolute genius when it comes to the high-speed shots. So what you end up with is this crew of really, really tightly knit people. We've all been working together for years and years, and we're all just as thrilled by what's going on as Jamie and I are on camera.
Yeah, it's all about doing the homework. And so in some cases, that behind-the-scenes work may take up to a couple of years before we get everything ready for us. And our actual shooting, on average, is a little over a week. Wow. So there's a lot behind the scenes.
So as a fan watcher of the series, I would sort of kind of my own words reduce your two different personalities, sort of Jamie thinks, Adam does, and sort of your thing is sort of like think twice, make once, and James is sort of like make fast twice, as fast as you can think once.
Well, yeah, or make three or four times.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, but as you said, it's not just this sort of stereoscopic two ways to do things, because there actually is another build team. So how would you describe sort of the method of, say, the other three on the team, you know, Tori, Grant, and Kerry? What's sort of their attitude about how you build?
Well, to be clear, they pretty much operate independently of us.
Right.
You know, the segments that they're doing are completely separate stories. They have a different way of working, which is, you know, I guess it's not quite this clear dichotomy that Adam and I have. It's a little bit more of a free for all, and it's a lot more tumultuous, I'd say.
Well, I think they also each one possesses very specific strengths that they really do bring project by project. Grant obviously has this great mechanical ability. Tori has this fantastic, if you need a frame to hold that car upside down, I can build that for you in a day. And Kerry has come back from having a baby. She had a baby last year. And she came back from having a baby, having taken this break, and has absolutely fallen in love with doing the show again, and has just busted out and done a couple of amazing things lately. We just watched this episode recently called Leather Cannon, in which Kerry, Grant, and Tori had to build a cannon out of leather. And Kerry turned I can't tell you what she did, but she turned this leather cannon into a piece of absolute fine art. I mean, Damien Hirst probably will look at it and go, oh, I can't believe I didn't think of that.
So there are different styles and different things that you guys have your own way of looking at problems. Would you say that there's sort of a general Mythbuster way of approaching problems? Something that maybe is sort of unique to your group of people that's not even done by other special effects groups or people making prototypes?
Well, I'll tell you, in special effects, one of the things that happens is you're often, I mean, one of the reasons that both Jamie and I gravitated gravitated towards special effects as a career is because you're doing something different every day, and you're often doing something that no one's ever tried before. I wonder if I can use a vacuum former on slumped laser-cut acrylic, for instance, and you try it out, and maybe it works, and maybe it doesn't. And so what it is this constant stream of problems to solve. And when you're solving problems, there is, at the beginning of any project, there's a set of problems you can see and others you can't. And you learn, as you're barreling into a project, at least I do, that I will approach the ones I can solve, but I'll be thinking about the ones I don't understand yet. And if there's a Mythbusters way of working, it is willingness to change on a dime. I mean, we did... Every single episode we do changes as we go every single day. We just did one water slide wipeout in which the narrative of the episode changed three times, each time for the last days of the experiment that we were doing it, because we were coming up with different results than we thought we would. And that type of dynamism, I think, really translates into the final product because it's not canned. We don't know where it's going, and we are able to still hammer a story out of it by the end.
Right. Well, there's also a thing that you see happening regularly with us that I don't know of any other type of thing that is on television that does this. Adam or I will both take a certain glee in welding something up at one side of the shop, and then, you know, the minute we're done with that, we go and sew something, you know, and it's, I mean, normally in industry or engineering or whatever, things are a lot more specialized. You know, if you want some mechanical thing done, you go to a machine shop. You want welding done, a welder, you go to a tailor for something. We just, with the same attitude, with the same kind of glee, we take a certain amount of glee in doing that. The same kind of joy will go, you know, from one of these things to another to another. It's all the same problem for us.
Well, I'll actually point out one more thing is our camera crew. Obviously, everything we do, we have to cover with lots of cameras, and there are a lot of cameras that get sacrificed in the course of telling the story. We have a row of just all burnt, soggy, destroyed cameras. We have a camera that actually filmed itself on fire. And live to tell the tale. But in the course of trying to figure out new ways to shoot something, our camera department actually comes to us and asks for help. But then often because we're busy on the show, our camera department has become really experts in different kinds of camera housings. And they're machining custom camera housings for cameras to do things that no one in their right mind should want a camera to do.
So you mentioned this sort of switching from welding to sewing, and in the show it's very obvious that you have a large set of skills, you know, whether it's deep diving, hang gliding, whatever it is. So I'm really interested in how you accumulate skills, because one of the things it seems that you're really both very good at is learning new skills. And this, maybe Mythbusters is sort of a platform for learning new skills. But can you say anything about how you learn a new skill? Like if I say, okay, you need to learn Excel spreadsheet today. Have you learned about how you learn a new skill?
It's all about curiosity. Okay. And that's pretty much just, that's it. And we're incredibly curious. We get into anything that strikes our attention and you figure things out. It's all the same, you know. Whether we're dealing with a sewing machine or a welder, it's a problem. It's a challenge.
You learn your own way through. You have to learn what your process is. I mean, I had to learn to make an Excel spreadsheet recently. Strangely, that you mentioned that, and you know that I know that. As I'm trying to figure something out, there is this point somewhere about 20% in where I just want to say, the hell with this. So I know that I have that mechanism, so I know that I should push past that and it'll be all right. I also know that somewhere about 70% into the completion of a project, and this is true, believe this, this is true on everything I've ever built. I'd be at Industrial Light and Magic working on a, you know, million-dollar spaceship, working on the final thing. 70% into a project, I always hit some point where I feel like, when is someone going to tap me on the shoulder and tell me to go home? I clearly have no idea what I'm doing. No one's tapping me on the shoulder? Okay, I'll keep going. And I know that, you know, you learn your mechanism for doing that. And both Jamie and I are lifelong generalists. Right. And neither of us is an expert at any skill that we possess. Right.
So, Jamie, do you think that you have actually gotten better at how you learn things?
Oh, absolutely. And we've working on the show in particular has radically changed us. We're different than we were when we started.
In what way?
It's almost like being able to look into the future when you because you acquire such a large foundation of understanding of things that from doing the and especially in our case we're seeing things pushed to their extremes. You know, engineers that are studying things in a formal way may not see things that have been ripped apart like we do, and so that kind of insight over all these different types of processes and things, it means that when we go into something that we have no prior experience mm-hmm. with, we immediately can gain purchase on it. And or at least much, much quicker than we used to be able to.
I'll say this. You know, one of the things I learned, I have gotten, it's not exactly true that we're not experts in any skill we possess. There are a few things which I think I'm an expert at. And in becoming an expert craftsman at those things which I have really gravitated towards, I've understood that a craftsman is not somebody who doesn't make mistakes. They make all the same mistakes that anybody does. They can just smell them coming a lot farther away. And that's a big deal. Right. And so we come to some new episode that's about some aspects of physics we have no clarity or understanding of, but we can smell where the problems might be in trying to tell the story from farther away. And the longer we do the show, the farther away we can smell it. Cool. You can see the episodes get more complex as the years go on.
I also have to say that it's not just about building things. I mean, since I started doing this show. Interestingly, I used to read a lot of fiction. We both of us are avid readers, and I was particularly fond of science fiction. Now it's pretty much all nonfiction, and the curiosity doesn't stop at building things. It's science and technology. I can't get enough, and so. Our minds have just expanded over, practically every aspect of our lives, actually.
So here's you mentioned reading science fiction when you were younger. What kinds of things were you interested in as a kid, when you were a little kid? I mean, I have this kind of vision of you in short pants and a beret and mustache when you're 10 years old. But I
pictured, yet Jamie was the same, only shorter.
Yeah, exactly.
Hello, mother. Hello, father. I'm off to school now.
But what, I mean, what were you interested in? Were you interested in science at the time? Were you interested in blowing stuff up? Were you the kid down the street who was, blowing stuff up?
No. I
was. Setting stuff on fire.
Yeah, I was kind of a rebellious kid. I'd say that's about it. I mean, I got very creative at figuring out how to get out of chores. I grew up on a farm.
What was the secret?
Well, the secret was that, I my dad, we had we lived on an orchard and, farm equipment. Generally, I found that if you take any kind of mechanical thing and run it into something repeatedly, it stops working. And then you don't
That's
have to do the
break.
Chore.
And how about you?
My father was a painter, first and foremost. And I grew up with him painting 2 or 3 hours a day, every single day. He raised us before I was born, he was in advertising, directed commercials, and was an art director. And got out of that because he hated advertising as a business, and raised me and my sister by doing animated spots for Sesame Street, which he would, in order to make the most money possible at them, storyboard, draw them, ink them, paint them, shoot them, all in the studio out behind our house in New York. So I grew up with somebody who also was a generalist. When I wanted a race car for my teddy bear when I was 8 years old, he made it out of fiberglass. And 1974 fiberglass was nasty stuff. But he would take on these challenges. And so I grew up watching somebody do that and watching somebody acquire those skills and be able to apply them. And I remember him telling me, look, your hand, because I have always had terrible, terrible handwriting. I remember him saying, handwriting is just like drawing. You just have to draw the words instead of think that you're writing them. And now I say to my kids, you know, sewing and welding are the same thing. It's just planes meeting each other. They're all the same.
So this is actually a question from someone in the audience. Who are your heroes? Was there anybody you really looked up to or even still look up to now as a role model, say?
I actually don't recall having a particular role model as I was growing up. I think now I definitely think of engineers. A lot of the engineers and scientists are just, you know, across the board are where it's at for me. And I don't think I ever had some one particular figure that was, and I guess my life would sort of illustrate that, because I've been all over the place. I've been a boat captain in the Caribbean. I've done all sorts of different things, and I didn't have that kind of focus, like one person that said, that's what I want to be.
How about you, Ed?
I gravitate towards the awesome generalists and communicators, people like Richard Feynman and Bucky Fuller. Mm-hmm. I can't get enough of reading about the way that they describe looking at the world and thinking about the way they're able to communicate about that, people like Carl Sagan.
And what was it about them that, besides their communication, that was teaching you?
Yeah, I think all three of those guys are people who realized that they had an uncommon ability to understand what was going on in the world, but also an ability to make that understanding parsable by other people.
Right.
And they took that role of being communicators really seriously. I recognize that what we're doing on the show, we're not engineers, we're not scientists, and it's barely science that happens on the show, but we're communicating something important, and we take that really seriously.
So this is sort of maybe the last question about learning, but I'm really very interested in it. You've worked together for many, many years, at least 7 years on the show. Adam, what have you learned from Jamie? And Jamie, what have you learned from Adam?
I look forward to hearing Jamie's answer to this. I've learned from Jamie never to throw out what seems like the stupid solution. Honestly, there are times when I'm sitting there going, well, we could machine a little arm, and Jamie's like, I got some chewing gum and I figured it out. Never, ever throw out that ridiculous solution, the one that you're stepping over to get to something that's elegant or that you think will be fun to build is probably the better solution than that. And the picking we do at each other on the show is a boiling down. It's a distilling. It's exactly what that is. You know, he says an idea, and I play devil's advocate, and I pick the parts away, and then he takes, I present an idea, he does the same. And then at a certain point, the right idea shows up, and we go, oh, that's it, let's do that.
So, Jamie, what do you say?
I would say it's, Adam just goes sometimes. When we're on the job, he just goes. And the fact is, sometimes that's just what you have to do, because you know, you start in on something. It's not perfectly clear where you're headed, how you're going to deal with this problem, and through our collaboration, a lot of times we find that we both just go and crap happens. You know, it works.
Well, great. The Energizer Bunny is your partner. That's fantastic. So here's a question from someone in the audience. It says, are there any segments you filmed for the show but decided not to air because you thought they were too dangerous to show or to demonstrate?
Usually that happens before we film the segment. there's a famous bit we did when we did the Hindenburg episode where we were going to ignite the thermite with a mixture of two common chemicals, and knowing that we would never air them, I did a piece to camera where I said, and I knew that if I held up the labels, they would blur them. Because that's what they do. And I said, now it's important never to mix blur with blur, because they get very hot. There's an episode we've been wanting to do forever on silencers, silencers for guns and for pistols and rifles, do they really sound as quiet as they do in the movies? Do they actually silence? How do they silence? What kind of sound? And it's a terrific episode, except that you couldn't go near it if you're us without doing homemade silencers. And then we can't figure out a way around teaching people how to make homemade silencers, which is a terrible, terrible hurdle for us. We just have the whole bottom half of the screen blurred. Trust me, what's going on under here is great.
So are there kinds of myths that you have not been able to do for expense reasons or moral reasons? Are there things that you would like to do but just haven't been able to?
Well, there's our favorite, which involves a myth about a, what was it, a manhole cover that got launched into space during...
supposedly the first man-made object in space is a manhole cover.
Yeah, it was. Really? They were doing underground nuclear testing, and, you know, it created such, you know, pressure. And
We tried scaling it so that the manhole cover was the size of a dime, and it still was like 14,000 pounds of dynamite 6 feet underground.
Yeah, anyway, we haven't got access to any nuclear weapons yet, so.
Not yet.
I don't know if you've heard about this myth about that we actually landed on the moon. Now, have you thought about trying to prove that? I mean, I know you did a actually go to the moon.
Oh, well, that of course, yes.
Absolutely.
No, that's at the top of our list. What we'd have to build the rocket ship.
We call the ship Salvage 2.
Yeah. Yes. So there is this one potential proposal called a one-way trip to Mars. Have you heard about that? The idea that the most expense in going to Mars would be coming back. So if you could just go there once, and then have maybe a fighting chance at the other end with kind of survival stuff.
I'd go.
And I think you'd be perfect because it would be financed by a reality show.
Yeah, there you go.
Just to see if anybody would make it. And I couldn't think of a better people on the crew than you guys.
Oh, God.
The thought of being cooped up with...
I just picture myself as this beret floats through. Amy!
So here's another question from someone here. It says, what's the hardest part of your job? I mean, is there anything you don't like about being a Mythbuster?
Look, it's we're having 7 years in and 180 hours of the show. We're having more fun now than we ever have. But part of having fun at your job means that you take it really seriously and you feel a tremendous amount of responsibility for it. That responsibility extends all the way out to the safety of our crew, which is... it's a difficult thing to maintain. And physically, the job is really taxing. We just finished shooting our second duct tape special out at Mare Island 2 days ago. But it's a shoot that we've been putting off for 6 weeks because of all this bloody rain. And this meant that we ended up having to do 4 weeks. Normally what we do is we'll spend a week in the shop. An episode takes about 2 weeks. We'll spend a week in the shop doing some building and small-scale experiments, and then we'll spend 4 or 5 days out on location doing the large-scale experiments. And that break, that oscillation really works because you come back to the shop after a big shoot, kind of chill and rest a bit and get back into it. Well, for the last month, we did 4 location shoots in a row, Michigan, Ione, California, Mare Island, and I can't even remember what we did before that, but we're all absolutely knackered at this point.
And I would have to say the actual filming is.
Hates being on camera.
Yeah. Well, we're actually interested in what we're doing, and what filming means is that whatever it is that we're doing is going to take many times longer to do than it would otherwise. And so, like I talked about, just sometimes you just have to go, and that for us to get. To pull off some of the things that we pull off, that's we have to go. And meanwhile, we're like, stop, wait for the camera to reposition. Or, everything is this whole ordeal because of us having to film. And, thankfully, it is a TV program. It has to be filmed, and I'm glad that it's popular. But
The number of times we are at the end of the day racing the sun as the sun is the shadow of evening is crawling across our set, about to ruin the high-speed shot, and we're trying to get it the last minute. That really probably happens at least once a month, every month.
So were there any myths that sort of completely stunned you, where you actually really believed that it was going to be true and were stunned to find out that it wasn't, or conversely, that you really believed that it was completely bogus and you were stunned to find out that it was true?
It happens more often than you think. I mean, obviously, narratively, there's a suspension of disbelief as we proceed down a storyline. But we did this one recently. The myth was that a dirty car is more aerodynamic than a clean car. I'm seeing some nodding heads. The myth is that the dirt creates some kind of boundary layer, like the dimples on a golf ball, that helps the car slip through the air. So, of course, we sprayed a car with river clay. We did some...
But what was your thought going in?
Our thought going in was it's total crap. No way. And we knew that the moment... So I've spent enough time on planes with Jamie bending my ear going, I don't know if that's really true. I don't know why they don't just make planes with dimples on them. And as soon as I heard that story, I was like, I know this is a good story because I know that the end, like a comedian knows where a joke is going to end up. I know that the end of this episode ends with a car that looks like a golf ball. And, I mean, that's all I knew. I also thought it was going to be crap. We went down to NASA to their wind tunnel where their wind tunnel, the head of their wind tunnel department is actually his particular penchant is golf ball fluid mechanics. And he was like, it's no way it's going to happen. And we found an 11% improvement in fuel efficiency on our golf ball car. Now, I will say that we got an email from GM.
I think it was Ford, actually.
Was it Ford? Yeah. It was basically a picture of, you know, at the big three, before they make a car, they make it in clay, and they do wind tunnel testing on it in clay. This was an unmistakable clay original that someone had clearly was in the middle of carving 1,000 golf ball detents in.
Cool.
They were like, well, if they got that result, we better try it out. They did not come to the same conclusion we did, so I think we'll be revisiting it.
So that actually suggests something, which is the formula for Mythbusters seems to be science plus explosions is great. If you have science itself, you're doing science by itself, like, say, Rough Science or these other ones, it's not as interesting as science plus explosions. But thinking about that, actually, it's actually sort of science plus extremism. Because I think one of the things that you do normally is you kind of progress, and then you say, well, what would it take to kind of really go and make it happen, not in an incremental way, but just go to the end? And I'm wondering if scientists are actually looking at what you're doing and saying, that's actually kind of a new way of doing science. Have you heard of anything like that?
We haven't heard that it's a new way of doing science. I want to point that when you say science plus explosion, it's absolutely true, even in the linearity of that, which is Mythbusters takes 6 acts. There's 5 commercial breaks in the course of a Mythbusters episode. All the science happens by the end of act 3. All the small scale is where we pretty much really figure out what the physics are. And the rest is, most of the time, a show or a chance for one of us to maybe get hurt. But what we get from working scientists is an appreciation of the demonstration of the methodology. And that's what we take seriously.
Well, I would also say that rather than science plus explosions, it'd be more like science and play. I mean, we're just being playful with these things. Sometimes that happens to involve explosives, but I think there's a sort of a non-linearity that goes along with that. That is often what happens when new discoveries are in fact made. You know, if you're just plodding down the path and you're not seeing all the stuff around you. I mean, we'll happily go down a certain trail and then do a right turn, at random someplace and go off in another direction, and that's where the joy is.
Right. So, thank you. So, do you feel that in the kind of large corpus of work that you guys have done, what has Mythbusters taught the world? What sort of been a major contribution, if any, of the program?
Well, if we've succeeded at anything, if you look at any forum that discusses Mythbusters, you'll see people complaining that we're idiots and we don't know what we're talking about. And then you'll see working scientists step up to our defense and say, No, they're you know, the iterations that they're using are pitifully small, and their conclusions are often based on scant evidence, but they are based on evidence that they've set out to achieve. And that methodology of applying the scientific method and demonstrating how messy it is and how willing we are to be wrong about it is one of my favorite things that we do on the show. The fact that we'll go back and read, like I said, we may revisit the dimpled car. That's great. I was thrilled with that result. I will be just as thrilled to be know that I was wrong or know that I was right. I'm agnostic about what the result will be. And the fact that we're out there demonstrating that science is messy, it's not somebody in a lab coat proceeding, as Jamie was saying, down a linear path. But it's sometimes we'll waste half an episode realizing we're asking the wrong question.
Great. Yeah.
You know, whether we achieve it or not, I think there's a certain kind of undercurrent of critical thinking and honesty that we'd like to put out there. And it does seem to be the case. I mean, the use of the word Mythbusters and busting something in myths, it's part of the popular lexicon now. Exactly. I don't know whether that's thanks to us or not, but it is telling about the impact the show's had.
So you guys were mentioning cars and maybe car companies coming back to you with maybe some of your ideas. Here's a question from the audience. It says, do you have any plans to investigate the Toyota acceleration issue?
Oh, what a hornet's nest.
That's known as a minefield.
Yes. Not that we would mind playing around in a minefield, but not immediately, no.
Okay. So here's another question. Have you ever been contacted or visited by government, either saying don't test this or do test this? In other words, have the men in the black suits come visit?
No, only I'll tell you, when Jamie and I are going through airports, air marshals find us all the time. The guys who are flying in secret, who are packing, in case anything goes down, they'll find us in the airport and go, hey, I like the show. And then they'll give us a little pin that says air marshal. We've got several of them. I did, right after it happened, I suggested to Discovery that we should immediately do the Dick Cheney shooting. And I'm going to try and do their response for you here. They went, no.
So here's another question from the audience. A lot of the myths have to do with paranormal stuff. Do you guys plan on doing very many busting of those kind of myths?
Doesn't interest us at all. I mean, there's a thing called trying to prove a negative that we generally avoid. Paranormal, supernatural, aliens, oogie boogie. What are you going to test? You know, it's like you go sit in a house and wait for a ghost to show up. I mean, it just doesn't work for me.
Yeah, we call that oogie boogie. We're not going to go look for the Loch Ness monster. We'd love to go look for a giant squid. We might water divining might be as close as we would get to that kind of thing. But even there is tricky territory. Pyramid power was a terrible waste of time for us.
So, is there anything that you've changed your mind about in the last 7 years?
I'm not sure I understand the question clearly. We change our minds constantly through the course of doing what we're doing, but are you talking about big picture stuff?
Yeah, something that you really thought you would never change your mind about, not maybe a myth, but something beyond that, that being involved in this has sort of changed how you think about things.
That's funny. That's a good question. I remember at some point being about 18 or 19 years old and thinking that I thought I knew what was going on about some aspect of my life. And then this other thought occurred to me, which is, think about now compared to 5 years ago. Yeah, you probably have no idea what you're going to be thinking in 5 years. And I think there's a willingness not to take ourselves too seriously that, yeah, we are both willing to have our minds change. And we have both fought, I mean, we argue all the time. And we have both fought bitterly for ideas which we gave up on a dime. Once we realized we were absolutely wrong.
Yeah, I would second that. It's a point of pride for us to change our minds. when confronted with evidence. And that has never become so clear as it has been with us because during shooting the show, because it's a constant situational. We're just daily we're doing that. We'll take a stand and then do a backflip because it's a point of pride.
Okay. So here's another question from the audience. Hobbies. Do you have any hobbies? You guys, in the morning, you blow up a plane. In the afternoon, you go underwater diving, and then you weld. Do you go home and collect stamps, or what do you guys do?
We both have access to this shop, the shop that we work in, and so, I mean, anything that you can dream up, you can make. The only problem is that we're sort of doing that every day for work anyway. So, I'm generally going home and reading. That's pretty much it.
For me, everything begins with objects. The whole reason I learned to make things is because I like holding on to things. And there are certain things I wanted to hold on to that nobody made, so I had to learn how to make them myself. And that extends into my personal collection of weird esoterica. I make a lot of it myself. And so that's also part of the... I guess that hobby falls under the rubric also of one of the ways I relax, which is by the same way I build things, which is I build things by putting the object in my head. You build it in your head first, and then everything else is cutting parts. And so for relaxation, I think of things that I want, and I slowly think about them for weeks, months, and sometimes years at a time about ways to approach the making of this or that part. And then the actual making of it may take 2 or 3 hours, but I'll have been thinking about it for 6 weeks, so when I got there, I'm ready. And that's the best way you could describe my evening activities.
Now, I've heard you have a hobby of replicating props.
I do.
So let me see if I understand what this is. So there are props that are used in Hollywood movies that are fantasy objects, and you're making a copy of a fake. You're making an authentic version of something that's not real.
Totally artificial. Yes.
Right. Right.
Well, I'm a massive, massive movie buff. I have hundreds of movies at home, and my wife and I watch them all the time. And movies have a great effect on me. And the objects in movies, the visceral connection, the emotions of a film, and the objects in the film are such that. I at some point decided I wanted my own Maltese Falcon, and I set out to to sculpt one and to make one and then have it cast in bronze as an interim, because eventually it would be cast in lead like the one in the movie. I have even considered doing a gold encrusted one at some point. The latest one, which I got out on the internet recently, I put it out there a little bit, was I'm replicating the pistol from Blade Runner. Which is a lovely, beautiful piece of science fiction memorabilia sold at auction last year for $250,000. And it's made from a couple of real guns and then a bunch of custom machine parts. And I have been slowly assembling it for about 6 years now. And I'm almost done. And by almost done, I might be a year away. Wow. I might be 2 weeks away. I'm not sure. It depends how it goes.
So we have these things where people make artificial fantasy objects for a movie, and then years later, people start making copies of them. I'm wondering if you look into the future, in 100 years, do you sort of make copies of the copies, or do the copies become realer than they began? So could you make your ray gun actually work?
At this point, actually, I could quite easily make mine into a firing weapon. As far as the continuation, I have these toolboxes that I built years ago when I was in the special effects industry, which started out as leather doctor's bags, but eventually they couldn't handle all the tools I owned, so I made them out of aluminum. And then because I like working at table height without leaning over, I put them on scissor lifts so they sat on either side of me. And in the end, they're no longer my toolboxes, but I still have them, and there's pictures of them on the website. And there is actually a group of people online who were trying to compile all the information they could from various pictures of what they'd seen on the show about my toolboxes. The same way that I'll go through a movie and screenshot and measure and figure out what part something was made from. So I immediately popped up on the forum and just gave, I took pictures of my toolboxes and gave them every dimension that they could ask for. Every part, every process. So to me, that's actually thrilling. In movie prop replication, it's often this archaeological process. I'm happy to completely subvert that and give anybody any information they want.
So thank you. I actually wanted to read a couple more questions from the audience. One of the ones was, have any of your discoveries turned into patents? Have you guys found something in doing this, these experiments that you thought, hey, this is actually patentable?
I suppose there's something that, well, there's something that I've been working on that has not become a patent at this point, but it's we're treating it as open source, and it's a direct result of the show, and that is that we're I've been developing lightweight armor, specifically aimed at deflecting blast pressure waves, and so because a lot of the armor that's out there is just massive, it's you know, you can't put it on Humvee very quickly. A thing like a Humvee will weigh twice as much as it normally would, and so they become unwieldy. And at the same time, you end up with blast pressures that you know, scramble somebody inside, even though the vehicle and the person is more or less intact. So these are our techniques for deflecting those, and that's being done through a contract with the Office of Naval Research.
Oh, cool.
So we're, you know, there are, and those this directly came from. All the weird things that we do with explosives, watching how the pressure waves reflect and all that kind of stuff.
Fantastic. Great. So another question. You both filmed a recent episode of CSI. What was that like?
That was great. We have a mutual admiration society with the writer's room at CSI, and they had written an experiment that we designed right into an episode. And so I got a hold of the number of the writer's room, and I called them up, and they said, you're not upset with us, right? And we're like, no, far from it. We're totally honored. So they sent some in Hollywood. I guess the thing is, once you've started a relationship, you all send over T-shirts. That's the equivalent of a handshake. So they sent some hats and T-shirts. We sent some hats and T-shirts. And then they sent us a script a few weeks later where we're written in, given the thumbs up through the window as they set fire to a ballistics gel dude. We are in the middle of filming an episode testing the very myth that that episode of CSI is about.
That's wonderful.
So and also, actually, from our standpoint, in this weird little zone of fame that we have, it was very fun to step onto a big Hollywood television show, and the crew was like, you know, everyone's been on the show and we don't care, but we brought our kids today. Can you come take a picture?
Yeah.
The crew, I mean, you know, we worked in the movie industry for a better part of, what, 30 combined years? That's what the credits say,
sure.
Right?
Right.
So, you know, those are our people, and it was really great to hang out right. with them for the day.
So since you guys have been in the special effects business so long, you're kind of like magicians, and magicians have this problem that it's really hard for them to enjoy magic because they know how it's being done and they're thinking about. Do you actually enjoy watching special effects movies, or do you find that yourself thinking too much about?
Well, aside from the fact that many of them are just plain awful.
Yeah.
No, I love watching them.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, pretty much the same. It's that's why we got into the effects world in the beginning, was we liked that stuff, and we still do.
Not for its own sake. I mean, both of good special effects work, like any work that you're doing in the course of doing a movie or a television show, is about telling the story. And so I can't watch something where the sets are beautiful but the story is crap.
Right. So let me be a little bit more speculative. You both work with machines all day long. Are you afraid that they're in the future going to take over?
You just can't. You have to make sure you don't switch that switch in their heads.
Right.
The kill switch.
So there are a lot of people who are very concerned about the amount of technology in the world. And there are a lot of people who extrapolate and they think about, well, look at what's happening. In another 100 years or 1,000 years, they're going to take over. So you guys actually work with these machines. Do you think they're going to, could take over?
I think what Adam said is actually the important thing. It's called a kill switch. You know, that's... It's you build a machine that is potentially able to misbehave, you put a kill switch on it.
Well, we actually had a discussion. Jamie designed a tracked vehicle that's a hybrid autonomous robot. And he's had some interest from the military in coming and playing with it and testing it and taking it out and running it through its paces. And we had this long talk about how, like, can't let him put a gun on it. Not allowed to put a gun on an autonomous thing. That's a bad idea. That's just an ethically bad idea, mechanically really bad idea. I know how machines work, and I wouldn't trust a machine with a gun as far as I could. It's the worst idea in the world.
But we're building them.
I find that really distressing. We had one of our early fights we had on the show was with a producer. We were doing explosive decompression. Well, firing a gun inside a pressurized plane caused it to fail and rupture and blow up. So we had this pistol with a remote control for the trigger, which is terrifying enough, inside the plane. And the producer wanted to put two bullets in the gun. Like, let's do two different tests. And I said, thinking it all the way through, thought, absolutely not. I cannot guarantee that after that first bullet fires, that gun doesn't somehow settle pointing at me.
Right.
No matter where I am, unless I'm behind something I know is bulletproof, that's not okay. One bullet at a time.
So we've actually had a couple questions about injuries and things, whether there's more injuries than is apparent on the show. And here's one question. How do you convince your wives that nothing will happen?
We tell them after. Jamie and I talked that, like, both of us have had the experience of, like, getting ready for bed at the end of the night and our wives going, where did that bruise come from? I have no idea.
So who has more scars?
I think we both have, I don't know. I thought this was not a large amount, like maybe 30 or 40 stitches from doing the show. Jamie's got a nice big shiner bruise on the underside of his arm right now from an experiment we did a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, I've got hundreds of scars. So, yeah, but a lot of those came from life on a boat before this. So
comparatively, this is actually a little tamer than
in some ways. Yeah,
The biggest injuries we've had on the set are, and it's really true, moving around the safety equipment. The bulletproof shields, the bullet-resistant shields that we stand behind, an inch and a quarter Lex Guard, and they weigh about 150 pounds apiece. And they're absolutely terrifying. We've had ankles twisted and fingers, I think we had two separate fingers broken by them.
Wow. And you don't show that normally on...
It's honestly, unfortunately, most of the spectacular injuries have not been while we're filming. I got one at some point early on when we were doing Break Step Bridge. I got a superficial but very large cut on my arm, and it was deemed too gross to air.
There is the safety issue, or the danger issue rather, is very real, and it's kind of a weird place that we're in now, where we've acquired more experience the longer we do this, and yet also the odds are that we're going to get bit at some point the longer we do this.
Right.
So where exactly are we at? I don't know, but it's a real issue.
Right, and your Twitter name is "Don't Try This."
Don't try this. Yes,
at home. So is that and also part of this issue about the fact that the more popular the show becomes, the more people want to try and do things just like it? I mean, you know, sort of neighborhood Mythbuster clubs where they're going to try something crazy?
We've heard little inklings like that. But I think one of the things we've done since the inception of the show is we've shown very clearly all the safety precautions that we take for any experiment. So if we're out there replicating some lethal occurrence that happens right here, we're talking about the fact that we're freaked out by it. We are standing behind bullet-resistant glass. We're talking about where the crew is standing. And we're showing shots of the EMTs and the fire department standing back there to come pull us out and put us out if such a thing becomes necessary. And I think that one of the reasons we do that is we want people to understand. And sometimes we go overboard with that, but we really just want to make it clear. We're thinking about the worst-case scenario. So please, you too, think about the worst-case scenario.
Well, also, I mean, it's a heck of a lot more than movies are doing, or even TV shows. I mean, just guns firing continuously, explosions, you name it, it's all over the media. And while we would, in the best of all worlds, not contribute in any way to people wanting to do dangerous things. It's a, you know, it's sort of a creative inhibition that we don't like. So all we can do is provide those kinds of warnings.
Right. So now after so many episodes, as you look to the future, what do you imagine Mythbusters heading towards? What do you think it can become? What would you like it to become that maybe it isn't right now? And will you run out of myths?
I'd like to answer in reverse. I don't think we're ever going to run out of material. As long as people are gullible and believe ridiculous things, we're going to have a job. One of the things that's happened over the years, we started out doing three myths per episode, at least three myths per episode. We've now gone to two and sometimes one. And over the years, we've realized that the stories that we're telling are more complicated and more complex because what might have been a full episode 5 years ago, we may take a piece of that episode and realize there's a whole episode in there. We start peeling this onion and dive into more complexity. The number of times in the last year we've had a story meeting about a story in which we threw out three quarters of the story to focus on 25% of it and made that the story, that happens all the time. And I see in the future more episodes where we're telling a single story over an hour and you're spending more time watching the process of the build and the convoluted way in which we come to those conclusions. I look forward to that.
Yeah, I mean, the world and the way people interact with it is really quite complex. And it's far more complex than we'll ever run out of the ability to get into.
And Mythbusters is based in San Francisco, but there are also some other institutions and sort of movements based in the Bay Area, like Tinker School, the tech shop down here in Palo Alto, which is a place that you can rent all the tools you guys have,
yeah.
Even if you don't own them, for a day pass, you can go in and you can use your plasma cutters and your computer-controlled milling machines. There is Make Magazine and the Maker Faire. There's, of course, the traditional Whole Earth Catalog, do-it-yourself stuff. Is this something, is there something going on? Is it just the Bay Area? Is it larger scale than that? Is this just a fad, or is this a reaction to the virtual sensation of people spending so much time in their front of their movies, I mean, their computer screens? What do you think, is Mythbusters part of something bigger?
I would like to think that it is. I mean, there's this thing about, you know, the mind and the body, and it's not, it's been sort of a tendency to separate the two. You know, you sit in a room and you think, and then, you know, somebody else does it. We don't see any difference between those two. It's all one. And so that it's natural that people would go in that direction as well. And I think you're right. All of the kinds of digital entertainment that that you can get that requires that you just sit someplace, mm-hmm. it's kind of I would think that people would have this urge to get out and do things.
I feel like we entered the world right at this crucial point in the zeitgeist, I think, of hacking your current technological reality, and I personally think it's sort of the same way we were with cars in the 50s, that cars were sort of this thing that only a few people worked on, but then it became this cultural phenomenon. Everyone was working on their own cars in the 50s. And then computers happened, and everyone thought, well, that's the end of DIY culture because no one can parse those little tiny things in there, those zeros and ones. Now, all of a sudden, Make Magazine is teaching you how to do it, and everyone's realizing that our brains can expand to accommodate the technology and start to make it do what we want. But more even than making it do what we want, we're demonstrating how we want the world to work. So, you know, Ev comes up with Twitter, and all of a sudden the users teach Twitter a whole new reason that Twitter should exist and ways that it should operate that they never thought of. And I think that type of conversation that really specifically the internet allows and that we like to participate in, and we've participated with Make Magazine and with Maker Faire and Tech Shop. Jimmy Neutron was an early researcher for us. Jimmy Newton, sorry. We called him Jimmy Neutron. You know, it's really fantastic to be in the middle of that community.
So there are a lot of young students here, kids. This is the last question we have time for. What what would you tell them that you wish someone had told you at their age? What's some bit of advice about making things, let's say, that you would like to tell them that you wish someone had told you?
That it's just really, really fun. You know, I mean, we're having a ball. You can see it on television, what we do. It's pretty much who we are. And I don't think that anybody ever, you know, it was like science and technology, engineering, whatever, it was something you did for school because you were told that you had to do it. You shouldn't have to be told to do it. It's like candy, to us. And it's very rewarding, I think, especially to young people if they look at it that way.
Okay, so it's fun.
It is fun. And you can actually, if you really understand that what you like to do, you can actually get paid to do something that's really fun. I grew up with that as an example. If there's one thing I would have told my young self running around, racing around, trying to figure out what I wanted to do, it's that you've got more time than you think. And that applies on the macro level of figuring out what you want to do with your life. I'm still working it out. And the micro level of, you want to make something, some parts of it are really boring and tedious. Actually, it doesn't take as much time as you think, and you've got that time. You take that time, you make the time, and the world's a little better because of it.
So even though you have more time than you think, we have less time than we think right now. We have to actually end this time. So I really want to have everybody give a great round of applause to Adam.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.